Assalamu alaikum to all of you. I want to begin with a verse from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Qad ja'akum basairu min rabbikum. It says, there has come to you an enlightenment from your Lord. And my quest today is to try and see if I can explore what this enlightenment really is. But before that, I want to congratulate Dr. Muhammad Hassan Alwan, Dr. Joseph Cohen, Mariam Hassan, and Alia and Alex for hosting this conference and doing whatever is necessary to put it together in such a short time. I think this is an important initiative. Inshallah, it will prove transformative. Creating space for philosophy is fundamentally necessary because I think that societies which do not have a spiritual dimension as well as a philosophical dimension will not be that intellectually vibrant as is necessary in this day and age, where knowledge is so profoundly instrumental in shaping society, in advancing society. We live in knowledge-based economies, knowledge-based societies, and to exclude one of the most profoundest forms of knowledge, which is philosophy, would be a mistake. So I think that this initiation of a dialogue about philosophy in order to understand the importance and significance of philosophy in education, in society, in public discourse is very, very welcome. In the last few decades, we have seen a lot of discussion about Islamic philosophy. But unfortunately, most of the discussion is in the form of history of ideas. So there are people writing books about what Ibn Rushd said, or what Al-Farabi said, or what Kindi said, and so on and so forth, trying to build encyclopedias on philosophy. So I see them as historians of ideas and not necessarily as philosophers. I remember hosting a conference long ago, more than 20 years ago at Georgetown University, calling for contemporary Islamic philosophers, Muslims today who employ philosophy to understand the world, to understand the challenges that we face, challenges from the environmental disasters, challenges from political disasters, challenges from economic disasters that we are experiencing in this world, and to provide a new perspective, a normative perspective even, on how human beings should live in this day and age. So I think that is the ultimate function of philosophy, is to provide new perspectives, new questions about understanding the world that we live in, but also to provide new directions. And even looking at old things from a new perspective, that is why philosophy is fundamentally important. If you look at all contemporary societies which are known to be intellectually vibrant, you will find that there are prominent philosophers nearly in each one of them. So for example, if you look at Germany, you have somebody called Jürgen Habermas, who has dominated the philosophical arena in Germany, just naming one of them. If you look at France, you have Foucault and Derrida. If you look at the United States, you have John Rawls, Saeed Hussein Nasr, Cornel West, Richard Rorty, a lot of people who have advanced philosophical ideas, new ways of thinking, which have had an impact on the education, on the pedagogies, on how we teach our next generation. India has Amartya Sen, and so on and so forth. So it is important for societies to allow space for philosophy, to allow space for new thinking. But I also want to say that there is inside the Islamic heritage and in the Islamic tradition an Islamic philosophical tradition called falsafa, which existed in the so-called golden age of Islam, and then it has kind of disappeared from our institutions, etc. There are some universities where you will occasionally run into professors who are either doing research on Ibn Khaldun or writing about it, or debating or engaging with Ibn Arabi and so on and so forth. But there aren't contemporary philosophers who are looking at the problems and the reality that we face from an Islamic philosophical perspective. So the first question I want to answer is that, is there such a thing as an Islamic philosophy? On this issue, I'm in complete agreement with Sayyid Hussein Nasr, who argues that there is a difference between reason and akal. The main currency of philosophy is reason. To look at the world and use reason as a way to understand and explain the world. But falsafa uses akal, and Sayyid Hussein Nasr argues that there is a fundamental difference between Aql and reason, because Aql, I mean, Aql is a word that comes in the Quran quite a bit. Yaqilun, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks people to use their Aql quite a bit in the Quran. So the Aql that comes in the Quran is a reason, a kind of reason that is shaped, informed, enlightened, and to some extent even restrained by revelation. So in Western philosophical tradition, you may have tensions between reason and revelation, which often then translates into tensions between science and philosophy. But in Islamic tradition, because the very conception of Aql is defined as reason that is enriched by revelation, we do not necessarily have that tension, but that tradition is not widespread. We do not have people who are constantly engaging in this argument or in this tradition. We're not teaching that. We are not doing research on these issues. And I hope that this Riyadh Philosophy Conference, inshallah, will become a venue where we can debate this contention that there is an Islamic philosophy and it has interesting things to offer, a perspective that will even inform the modern Western, and not necessarily Western, but even Eastern philosophies, which often ignore certain normative aspects that are very dear to the Islamic heritage and tradition. So the second part of the term, enlightenment, what is enlightenment? And is there such a thing as an Islamic enlightenment? This part of my paper is informed by two of my works. So one is a paper called What is Enlightenment in an Islamic Perspective that was published in a journal called Journal of Religion and Society, and a book on Ehsan that I published just a year and a half ago, in which I look at the concept of Ehsan and argue that since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that we show Ehsan in every aspect of our life, why not in governance, why not in public sphere? And so developed a political philosophy of Ehsan. And so the idea that I will share with you now are from these two sources. For those of you who are interested, you can go and take a look at it. Immanuel Kant, in an essay that he wrote called What is Enlightenment, defines enlightenment in a very fascinating way. He argues, and I'm quoting him, that he defines enlightenment as man's emergence from self-imposed immaturity. And an enlightened man for Kant was one who had the courage to use his own understanding. And then Kant goes on to argue that societies can come out of a state of immaturity if only people had the courage and freedom to use reason publicly in all matters. So I'm relying heavily on this definition of enlightenment. Enlightenment as a condition where people are confident of their reason and they're trying to exercise their reason in all matters and publicly. So it is a combination of employment of reason and courage. So it's not just that you're using reason privately, but also publicly. And to have this confidence, in yourself, this is enlightenment. The Muslim societies, if you look around the world, it is a contentious assessment, but some of us feel that we could be more vibrant, more intellectually advanced, more scientifically advanced, given all the resources that we have in human resources, as well as wealth, etc. But we seem to lag in knowledge development from Western societies, and including from Eastern societies now, like India, China, and Japan, and the Asian tigers. And one of the reasons why people have argued is because there is a hesitancy towards innovative thinking in the Muslim world, that Muslims are hesitant. And some people have argued that we are living in an era of new jahiliyyah. So my contention to you is that Islamic enlightenment is an escape from self-imposed jahiliyyah. And to get to that stage where the Quran says basairu. And the Quran in many places, I mean, uses the word kitabun muniran to describe the Quran, talks about the prophet as sirajun muniran. So there is a lot of emphasis on enlightenment in the Quran. And so to me, an Islamic enlightenment is when Muslims are escaping a self-imposed jahiliyyah and they are willing to use their aql in all matters and publicly so. So let me give you an example of this. If you remember the hadith that is often used to justify ijtihad, this is when Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, appointed his companion Mu'adh ibn Jabal as the governor of Yemen, may God be pleased with him, and asked him, how will you govern? And he said, I will follow what is the teachings of the Quran. And then he was asked, what if you don't find the answer there? He said, I will follow your tradition, O Prophet of God. And he said, what if you don't find the answer in that? Then he said, I will use my independent judgment. And oftentimes people say this is the justification for ijtihad in Islam. But this assertion of Mu'adh ibn Jabal that he will use his independent judgment, this confidence, is what to me is the sign of an enlightened Muslim, an enlightened person, to be able to recognize that I have the capacity to reason and I can find answers to this reason, and I'm willing to use it publicly and in public matters of public policy, of governance, etc. I also want to recall another tradition in which a person came to the mother of believers, Aisha, and asked her, can you describe to me the personality of Prophet Muhammad? And she said, have you not seen the Quran? The personality of Prophet Muhammad was exactly like the Quran. And this tradition has become very famous, where people have started talking about the concept of the walking Quran, the Prophet as a personality that embodies all the teachings of the Quran. But what did she mean? And this is where I want to give you a small demonstration of how Islamic philosophy would function. So if an Islamic philosopher were to read this tradition, and he would say, so what does Aisha mean when she says that the Prophet is like the Quran? The answer is in the Quran. The Quran describes itself in many, many ways. In chapter 25 and chapter 8, the Quran says, blessed is he who has revealed unto his slave the Furqan. And elsewhere it says, O you who believe, if you fear Allah, he will grant you a Furqan. So the Quran is described as Furqan. The word Furqan means to have the capacity to discern between what is right and what is wrong, to have the capacity to discern between what is just and what is unjust, what is manifest and what is hidden. So this quality of discernment is what Furqan is. So when the mother of believers, Aisha, says that the personality of the Prophet is that of the Quran, as an Islamic philosopher, I understand that is that she's referring to this quality of the Prophet to be able to be discerning as to what is right and what is wrong. And I think that is what is the purpose of education. That we educate our children, we educate our members of the society, we educate others to develop this capacity of discernment, to be able to judge what is right and what is wrong. It reduces the role of the state, because people who are, if you have a citizenry which is discerning and enlightened, therefore, is able to do its own ijtihad and come to the conclusion about what is right and what is wrong, then it will become a self-governing society and will not require the state to police it all the time. And that is where we want to go. We want to go to a point where human agency is so polished, so nurtured, that individuals become free of the self-imposed restrictions that we have put on our reason, on our aql. They become people who have the quality of the Furqan, who become discerning individuals who can then make independent judgments. We have to trust humanity. This, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ التَّقْوِيمِ. The Quran says we have created you in the best of modes. If we cannot trust the best of God's creation to use the reason that God has given them, then what is the point of being a human being? What is the point of having moral agency? We cannot have moral agency without having a trust in our capacity to reason. And that is what is the ultimate purpose of philosophy, is to create an enlightened citizenship. When Al-Farabi writes his book about the opinions of the citizens of the virtuous state, why is he concerned about the opinions of the citizens of a virtuous state? Because he realizes that you cannot have a virtuous state without having an enlightened citizenship, and that enlightened citizenship's opinions are important because they have achieved this capacity of Furqan or discernment. So how do we, as a society, what kind of pedagogies can we use in our schools, in our society, in our culture, in order to be able to produce individuals who can be transformative in their own societies, in their own environment? And for that, I think that we need four freedoms. I feel that today, Muslim societies need these four freedoms to become intellectually vibrant. And I'm going into an arena which is slightly controversial, so please listen very carefully. Do not misquote or misunderstand. Do not jump to conclusions that would be unphilosophical of you. So the first freedom, okay, all right. So one freedom per minute. So the first freedom is the freedom to become an apostate. Muslims should have the freedom to leave the deen if they want to do that. What has happened in Muslim societies is every time somebody comes up with a critical posture, with a new idea, with a new theory, that individual is immediately threatened and declared an apostate, a murtad, and his life is in danger. The strategy is that you take an individual and say, oh, you said this, so you are now committing blasphemy, and therefore you're outside the faith. And now that you are outside the faith, it is justifiable to kill you. This scares scholars, this scares intellectuals, this scares professors, not just philosophers, even theologians, even scholars who are rethinking on how to apply Islamic law in today's day and age. Even they are afraid to bring out ideas. So there is a fear of thinking in societies where this danger of being accused of apostasy is so prevalent. So the first thing we need to do is to be free. An Islamic state is one which provides its citizens the freedom not to be Muslim. That is the important thing to do. Number one, freedom. That an Islamic state and an Islamic society is Islamic because it allows its citizens to be able to challenge whatever value systems we have. Number two, that we should have the freedom to challenge ijma, the past ijma. We should be able to go back and challenge the past consensus whose tyranny often constrains intellectual thought today in the Muslim world. So Muslim scholars should not be threatened because they are questioning the ijma of the past. If the ijma of the past was robust, it was based on very strong arguments, then it will withstand critical discussion. But if the ijma of the past was based on politics forced by rulers, then it will crumble. So I think this is fundamentally very important for Muslim societies in particular to have the freedom to challenge ijma. Look at what is happening in the United States today. The 1619 Project is challenging the fundamental ijma of how and why the United States was created. It is questioning the consensus about the origin of the United States. And it will only empower the US. It will not weaken it. The third thing, freedom that we need to have, is to have the freedom of ijtihad. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that he who does ijtihad and gets it wrong, who thinks independently and gets it wrong, he has one reward. And who thinks independently and who does ijtihad and gets it right will get two rewards. I have never seen such an incredible license to think freely, where he's saying that even if you get it wrong, it's meritorious. So this is an incentive for Muslims to think independently and to reason independently. And finally, Muslims should have the freedom to deliberate on matters of governance. This is very critical. I mean, there is a chapter in the Quran called Shura Bainahum. It is important for individuals to be part of the direction, the decisions that determine the directions in which their society is going. So they have a stake in the future. They have a stake in the vision. And that society is empowered because the individuals have bought into the vision of the the nation, and therefore they are moving in that direction. So I feel that unless we have these four freedoms available to us in Muslim societies, they have to be obviously in schools, particularly in universities, especially in areas where advanced research is going on in social sciences, public policy, other places. Freedom not to be accused of apostasy. Number two, freedom to challenge ijma. Number three, freedom to do ijtihad. And number four, to have the freedom to engage in deliberations about public policy making. So these are the four things. Only then can we have a citizenship which will have the attribute of Furqan, and we will have an enlightened society. And I think philosophy can play an important role in taking us on this path and creating that society which will make even Al-Farabi jealous. Thank you.